It's that time of year again!
Lexington Comic Con!
It's Comic-Con 2017, and once again, we're taking your questions to your favorite creators.
All right, we are here with Mike Grell, and we had a fan submit a question for you. And since you worked on Legion for so many years,
yes,
and Legion is sort of making a bit of a comeback these days, they were just curious, who was your favorite?
My favorite Legion character was actually Lightning Lad, even though I created Dawnstar. Lightning Lad has got the coolest costume in the face, and he's got the coolest power.
Awesome. All right. Well, thank you for answering our question, and thank you for coming to Lexington. All right, we hope you have a great time at the con.
Thanks. Coming on and see us.
All right, we are here with Neal Adams. We had a fan-submitted question for you. They said, if you were to collaborate on a Batman book with Scott Snyder, specifically, what villains would you like to use with him as a creator?
I think if I were to work with Scott Snyder, I would want to join him and create new villains. I mean, we've all kind of, each of us have done all the villains that we know. Why not come up with something new?
Yeah, that would be awesome.
Otherwise, it'd be a waste of talent, don't you think? I mean, why put two talented people together unless they can come up with something that's new and different? So I would go with that.
Is there any sort of villain you've always had in mind that you'd like to do, or would that be like a secret you'd have to keep to yourself?
Not at all. I think the idea of creation is you sit down and you say, okay, what hasn't been done, and then you go ahead and do it. So no, I have nothing sitting in the back of my head that I haven't done, because if I did, I would have done it.
Yeah.
Awesome. That's a great answer. Thank you for talking to us today.
I'm glad that you thought it was a great answer. I'll come to you if I have any questions in the future that need grading.
Awesome. Okay. All right. Thank you. Okay, so we are here with Rob Guillory. We had a couple questions submitted to you from the show. The first one is pretty straightforward. What is your character design process like?
Oh, okay. I don't know if I really have a character design process. I think I just kind of I look at what I'm looking for, like in a character, like in terms of the two characters. You know, they actually came to me. John came to me. John Lehman, the writer of Chew, came to me and said, "Well, you know, I'm thinking, you know, Mason Savoy, maybe you know, think of Orson Welles." So I kind of used that as a starting point and kind of went from there and kind of grew him into something bigger. And with every character, it kind of tends to be that way. Like, you know, on the stuff I'm working on now, which is all totally original stuff, I'm kind of thinking, you know, what actor would I want to play this role, and then work from there and kind of turn it up to 11 and go overboard with it. So that's kind of a general rule, I guess.
Awesome. That actually, what the last thing he said almost leads us to our next question, and that is, now that Chew is finished, what do you have planned next? What's coming to us?
I'm working on a solo project that I'll be writing and drawing. I'm already two scripts are done, and I'm actually trying to get most of my writing done up front since I'll be doing the art also. I've already gotten two issues written, and I'm planning it to be a 20-issue series, so four or five issue arcs. Yeah, you know, if the sales allow it, we'll see. I'm planning on that starting to come out end of the year, maybe. But also, me and John Lehman are starting to develop something else. We actually already have a pitch that was approved, that image. It's just a matter of when that'll be. But I'd expect something by the end of the year.
Can you tell us a little about either one of them, or are you trying to keep it under wraps?
Not yet, no.
Right on? No, I totally understand.
I'd expect some kind of announcement, probably like summer or fall, maybe.
Awesome. Yep. All right, we'll be on the lookout for it. We'll talk about it on the show.
Cool, thanks.
Awesome, thanks, man. I am here with a gunslinger. Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Hi, I'm Yaya Han. I'm cosplaying as the Hyperion gunslinger from the video game Ion today. And it's a Lexington Comic Con. I had a great time last year. And if you like cosplay, please find me at yayahan.com. And I'm also post every day on Facebook under Yaya Cosplay, or you can find me on Instagram at Yaya Han. Very easy to find.
Awesome. All right, is there anything you'd like to talk to us about today?
Well, I have super awesome, exciting news because I have a fabric line with Joanne Fabrics, and we're coming out with a new collection. It is hitting stores right now, and it's going to have a bunch of new materials that I've wanted to bring. It's wovens like peony and taffeta. So we have ombre spandex coming. So great fabrics for making costumes. I hope you guys like it. Go to your local Joann's, check it out in person, and I can't wait to see what you guys make.
Awesome. All right. Thank you for talking to us today.
Thank you.
Hadouken!
All right, we are here with Jim Mahfood, and we had a question for you for the video. We had one of our viewers ask me, if you were going to do another Stupid Comics, what would be in it?
Whoa, basically just updated versions of the same satire, making fun of politics, pop culture, basically the same stuff I was doing in the early 2000s, but just replace the names. You know, Britney Spears with whatever the top pop personality is now. I don't know, Taylor Swift. Replace George W. Bush with Trump, and you basically have the same jokes, same satire. Like, nothing much really has changed. It's the same kind of nonsense that still goes on in our culture, so.
The more things change, the more they stay the same.
Yeah. That's why I haven't revisited the comic. It's like, well, the comic didn't work. I was trying to change things through my art, and it didn't work, so there's no reason like repeating myself, you know.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, thank you for taking a minute to talk to us today. I hope you have a great weekend.
You too.
We are here with Lord Beerus. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hey guys, my name is Soni Aralynn. I'm here at Lexington Con. This is my third time here. I love being here. But anyways, obviously, I'm a cosplayer. I make my stuff. You can find me on Instagram, Patreon, Facebook, all under my name, Soni Aralynn. So I'd love to see you there. So come by and follow my stuff.
Hey, this is James Maddox, and
I'm Eric.
Hey, we are the guys that run Tri-State Comic-Con in Huntington, West Virginia. This year we're going to be having it on June 3rd, and it's going to be filled with comic creators and maybe a little voice actor.
Some voice actors. So we've got Neal Kaplan, who is Emperor Zarkon from Voltron. We fill all 55,000 square feet of the Big Sandy Superstore Arena in downtown Huntington, West Virginia. It is our sixth year. We're the largest show in West Virginia. We are Tricon, West Virginia's Comic-Con. So make sure you check us out at triconwve.com. And you can also check us out on Facebook. We
Absolutely.
Hope to see you at the show June 3rd.
How you doing today, Kylo Ren? I hear you have an 8-pack. We are here with the artist on punks, which is related to our question. Do you like to take a second to introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Kody Chamberlain, artist on punks, co-creator, and I also wrote and drew a story called Sweets, a New Orleans crime story.
All right, we had a fan submitted question for you. They were a fan of your book.
Awesome.
And they want to know, what is your favorite punk rock band?
Oh, favorite punk rock band. I don't know. Who can pick a favorite punk rock band? I don't know. Black Flag, maybe.
And that's a solid answer.
Yeah, good day, maybe. Yeah.
Awesome. All right. Well, thank you for taking a moment to talk to us today.
Cool.
And I'm a big fan of punks as well.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you for coming to Lexington, man.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
I'm a dog. Half man, half dog. I'm my own best friend.
Here with Joshua Hale Fialkov. And we had a question submitted to you from a fellow writer. They wanted to know, do you think there's a major difference between writing for video games than writing for comic books?
So I'm very lucky in that I get to work in like 5 mediums right now. So I write video games, I write comic books, I write TV, I write film, animation. There you go, and animation. I think there's a lot of crossover, right? So the important stuff is about story and character. All that stuff sort of applies across mediums. the hardest part is actually switching how your brain works, because there's things that work in each one that doesn't. So for example, you know, in a video game, and this is why most video games don't work as movies, video games are really about being immersed. So the story that the character is going through has to be a story that the player feels in a very like emotional first-person way, even in a third-person game. Whereas in something like comics, it's very much about engaging the viewer's imagination by filling in gaps, right? So they're looking at the comic, and when you see the gutters between the panels, they're actually filling in that space. A video game is much more immersive because you're literally seeing this super realized world. So the tricks you have to use are just way different. Even then going to like the difference between writing TV and writing comics, which are very similar things, the truth is that it's hard because in TV, you're dealing with a set of limitations that you don't have in comics in terms of budget, in terms of production, like producibility, in terms of network, in terms of all those things you have to fight. But at the same time, in comics, because you're using representations of people, it's actually harder to get emotional responses out of people. Everyone can relate to another human being's face when they see an actual person, versus having to relate to an abstract drawing of a person, you know, or a facsimile of a person. So that's my answer. Is that a good answer?
Yeah.
It's a lot of answer.
No, it's all right. It was very, very in-depth. Very interesting. All right, we have one more follow-up question for you. We also asked your art partner, Cody Chamberlain, who is your favorite punk rock band?
I mean, it's probably the Ramones, because they're the Ramones. I'm very, like, they're hard to top from influence. But I'm actually a huge Buzzcocks fan. I think the Buzzcocks are just amazing. And that they managed to go from writing, I like to use that, you know, within a few years they did both Orgasm Addict, which is ridiculous, and Have You Ever Fallen in Love? You know, like, they managed to do, like, run the gamut in a way that few bands did. So it would definitely be the two, between the two, at the very least.
Awesome. I personally think that is a great answer.
Thank you.
All right, thanks for taking the time to talk to us today, man.
Thanks so much. Thanks for asking, guys.
All right. We are here with David Mack, and we had a fan submitted a question to you, and they said, first off, they love all of your covers and your prints.
Thank you.
But they want to know, when will they get to see another all David Mack book like Kabuki?
Well, that's a good question. I do love the idea of doing brand new Kabuki work, although, you know, I've got four of these right now from Dark Horse that collect the entirety of all the Kabuki stuff. Each one of these is over 400 pages, so there's 1,600 pages of Kabuki story out right now, and it'd be so wonderful to jump right back into a Kabuki story. I did some brand new Kabuki stories that I included in this for the collection, and once I was doing it, I just loved being in the zone of it and wanted to do more Kabuki. But I also felt like I've got 1,600 pages of Kabuki stories out right now. I should probably do some other creator-owned projects before I do more Kabuki stuff. So working on some new creator-owned projects right now, and working on some other collaborative projects as well. So I couldn't give you an exact date on that, but that's kind of my my overview of the landscape.
But it's coming is what you're telling us, huh?
Yes, sir.
Awesome. All right, well, thank you for coming out to the con, man. I hope you have a great weekend.
Thank you so much.
We are here with Zatanna. Why don't you take a moment, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hi, my name is Ivy Doomkitty, and I am a professional cosplayer. I'm here at Lexington Comic Con having an absolute blast. You can find me through all my social medias at ivydoomkitty.com and on everything under Ivy Doomkitty, really. Also, my fan club, which has exclusive content, which is patreon.com/ivydoomkitty. I'm actually a big, big, big advocate on body confidence and body positivity. So I feel like everybody should be able to cosplay, regardless of your size or your skin color or your age, anything really. You know, it's about having fun and sharing the love of your favorite characters with everybody.
Awesome. All right, is there anything else you'd like to talk to us about today?
Yeah, actually, one thing that I love about cosplay is the ability to give back to the community and to also help others, you know, as well as charities. And one that I absolutely love to work with is Kid Crusaders, which is a nonprofit cat charity based in Southern California, where we help save cats and kittens from high kill shelters. Since there's such a high kill rate in the state of California, we try to pull as many as we can, get them fostered out, vetted, and then also adopted out. So if you guys get a chance, would love you guys to check it out. It's Kit Crusaders, which is KITTCRUSADERS.org. Feel free to donate there, as well as take part in any of the charity prints, which have myself, Katrina Law, Michael Rooker, a lot of people from Arrow and The Flash all have contributed time to take photos, and 100% of the proceeds go directly to our group.
Awesome.
Just for the kitties.
So, awesome. Save the kitties.
Save the kitties, save the world.
We are here with Peter David. We had a fan submitted question for you. Was, given how much you've written Jamie Madrox over the years, how did you feel about the way Marvel chose to kill him off in Death of X?
Jamie Madrox is not dead. The guy we saw in that issue was wearing a costume that he hasn't worn in 15 years, and there was no M tattoo on his face. There's no freaking way that was Jamie Madrox. I don't know who that was, and if I ever have the opportunity to do so, I'd be happy to come up with a story to explain it. But that was not Jamie Madrox.
Awesome. All right, thank you for taking the time to talk to us today.
You're welcome.
I hope you have a great con.
Me too.
Destructo Disc! All right, we are here with Darryl Banks. Last year you told us all about how they censored your refrigerator page on us. We have another question for you again this year.
What's
that? They wanted to know, what was your reaction when you first heard that Hal Jordan would be a villain?
Well, now, technically, he wasn't so much a villain, more pushing more anti-hero. He was kind of unique. You know, when he was more of a... You ever had a situation on your job where something happened, was unfair, and you were frustrated about it? It didn't necessarily make you a villain. You were just fed up with some inequities, that sort of thing. That's kind of how we saw Parallax. More of a... Not so much the hero that he was, but more frustrated to a breaking point. But it was one of those things where it was great to be on the ground floor or something like that. And over time, he became even a bigger deal to the company. When he first appeared, he didn't have a cape, and they felt that, you know, they had bigger plans for him, especially with Zero Hour, so they had me design a cape for him. So, I enjoyed it a great deal.
Awesome. All right, well, thank you for taking the time to talk to us today. I hope you have a great weekend.
Oh, my pleasure. Have a great weekend.
We are here with Cory Lewis, and we had a question for you from one of our viewers. They wanted to know, what was your inspiration for Sun Bakery?
Oh, a lot of different things, considering it's an anthology of a few different stories. The big ones would be Metroid, because one of the comics is a Metroid parody. Shonen Jump, because of the format of Shonen Jump is very similar to Sun Bakery. Dragon Ball, Final Fantasy, stuff like that.
Alright, and then the other question they had is, what's key to your comic character's design / fashion?
Ooh, I don't know.
You like this one.
Yeah, I just kind of freshness is a good one. I like to play this game called Splatoon, where the characters say, stay fresh, all the time, and I'm like, oh, that's like a good catchphrase for my characters. I don't know, I like to study like fashion and the fashion magazine Fruits from Japan. I study that one a lot. So, I don't know, just as long as it's appealing to me. I guess the rule of cool applies there, so.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. Alright, thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
Alright, I hope you have a great weekend.
You too.
We are here with Chris Schwizer. We have a question for you from one of our viewers.
Okay.
And they said, when you are working on your historical fiction, do you do a lot of research before you start sketching, or do you keep a collection of historical reference photos around? How does that go down?
So when I'm dealing with the historical subject stuff, a lot of times I will really, really invest myself in a particular period, or immerse myself, I should say, and study as much as I can with it. Some of that is reading firsthand accounts of things, looking at costumes, visiting museums and battlefields when I can, things along those lines, living history stuff, whatever I can rustle up. And I'll just do nothing but that for, you know, X amount of time, especially if I'm working on a book during that particular period. And what I'll usually do is start, you know, doing a lot of sketches and cataloging things, and eventually I'll have this sort of mental morgue, this catalog that I can draw from whenever I'm dealing with those characters. So Westerns, for example, I don't really have to do much research or reference for Westerns because I spent, you know, a year drawing a whole lot of Western stuff from as much reference as I was able to find. You know, same with mid-19th century New York, same with pirates, same with like late 12th century, early 13th century. So that's kind of how I roll with it. So I do have a lot of reference books, I do have a lot of things like that, but usually what will happen is I'll exhaust them until I feel like I have it all internalized, and then at that point I kind of abandon them. I still keep them, and I have them on hand if I need them, especially for dates and factual information that I usually compile with whatever I'm working on. But art-wise, that's my hope, is to figure out how a period works, get it all inside me, and then be able to pull it up at a moment's notice. So.
Awesome. All right. Well, thank you for taking the time to talk to us today.
Thank you so very much for chatting with me.
Awesome. All right. I hope you have a great weekend.
You too.
We are here with Kyle Starks, and we had a question for you from one of our viewers, and they want you to name your top five 80s revenge slash hero movies.
Oh, man. Do they have to be revenge-based, you think? I'm going to go, like, 80s, Roadhouse, Die Hard. Oh, this is so hard. Commando. Blind Fury. Murphy's Law, but only because that's what I'm thinking of right this minute. I know I'm leaving out 1,000 good ones.
Hey, no, those are the first one that comes to mind, man. There's got to be something special about it.
I'm going to tell you that's a Money 5 list of 80s shenanigans, though.
All right, thank you for talking to us today, man. I hope you have a great weekend.
I'm going to do the best I can. You do the same. Awesome. All you folks do the same.
We are here with Bill Hargreaves, legendary prop creator. And we had a question submitted for you from one of our viewers, and they want to know, outside of Star Wars, what prop are you the most proud of working on?
Oh, I guess that would be the coat hanger on Raiders.
The coat hanger on Raiders?
Yeah. Do you not remember the coat hanger on Raiders?
Yeah, the fold-up coat hanger.
That's the one, yeah.
So that wasn't just an actual product. You came up with that for the movie?
Yeah.
I never knew that.
It wasn't really in the script. It was said as a, we want something that looks very mundane, but is actually looks like a torture implement as well. Hence the coat hanger idea came apart. So when it was in its loose state, it looked like nunchucks with a vicious hook on the end. And then you hook it together, it's a pure coat hanger. It was pure film fantasy.
So specifically the script didn't tell you it was a trick coat hanger, you came up with it being the coat hanger?
Frank Marshall came in and said, I want something along the lines of a coat hanger or an umbrella or something.
Something said, simple.
Give me something. And
awesome.
I did.
That's really neat backstory.
Yeah, and so it came apart by sitting, drinking coffee and just thinking.
Thank you for taking the time to talk to us today, and I hope you had a good trip over here. I hope you're enjoying Lexington, man.
I had a lovely trip. Great place. Love it.
I'm here with Tania Seven. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hey guys, I'm Anamia, and I'm here at Lexington Comic Con. You can find me on Facebook under Anamia.cosplay or on Instagram and Twitter, Anamia Official.
All right, is there anything you'd like to tell us about today?
If you check out my social media, I'm actually running an ongoing charity drive with donated school supplies for public schools around the DC metro area. So check it out on my social media, and let's help out the future of our kids.
Awesome, that's great. Thank you for talking to us today.
Thanks.
We are here with Beau Smith. We have a question submitted to you from one of our viewers who happens to also be a writer. And they wanted to know, how does it feel to have a TV show based off one of your comics? And do you think people understand the daunting process of seeing a comic make the transition to TV?
It feels surreal. When I went up to the set, met all the actors, and I actually got to direct a scene and stuff, the 12-year-old in my head that's still there said, your head's going to explode. This can't be happening. It was quite unreal to see a character that I created 20 years ago hold up the badge to the camera and go, one owner, U.S. Marshals. So instead of goosebumps, I got moose bumps. I mean, they were that big. It was unreal. And as far as the transition from comics to a TV show, it's very neat in the fact that you get to see something that's been in my head, in this case, since third grade, transport into something that's alive. There are people walking around saying these phrases and words that a lot of them that I've invented. And also to work in the process of television, to take something I've done for 20 years in comics and then for it to go to television. Emily Anders, who's the showrunner, has added all these extra layers to something. I always like to put it, I've baked a loaf of bread, but Emily has taken and fed the world with that one loaf of bread. She has brought so many new readers into the mythology and universe of Wine on Earp. It's just unbelievable.
All right. Well, thank you for taking the time to talk to us today, man. I hope you had a great weekend.
No problem, Zach. Thank you, bud.
Oh, no.
Hello, Jason Mewes, and thank you for having me here at Lexington Toy Comic-Con, Comic-Con, Comics and Comics and Toys. Snooch the Nooch, check it out, check me out, butt naked on Jay and Silent Bob, get old, download it on iTunes, and there's other stuff. Check it out on my Twitter, Facebook, and all that, J-A-Y-M-E-W-E-S, at Jay Mewes, where you can find all my good stuff.
I want to say thank you to Jerry Greer for running an awesome Comic-Con this year. Everything was great. We had a super great time. I hope all of you guys did too. I can't wait until next year. My pick of the week this week is Amazing Spider-Man 25. It's the return of Norman Osborn, and you can pick that up on Wednesday. Don't forget, our big anniversary sale is this weekend. It's 20% off your entire purchase. I hope to see everybody there.